Okay, is this on? Good. So, any questions for Mr. Brown? Please come up to the front of the stage. Okay, I could take one over here. If you could line up over here, I'll give the first one here.
In fact, it's not so much a question than a suggestion that might help Muslims accept the post-Enlightenment values. And that is to highlight to them that they have their roots in the golden age of science and Islam. I mean, highlight that Enlightenment has its roots in Al-Kindi, Al-Furabi, Avicenna, Ibn Rushd. Wouldn't they accept those values better if they know that they're actually their values too and have their roots in the golden age of Islam?
You're saying that we should focus on the fact that science or Islam once upon a time was the where science was abundant, where a lot of scientific progress went. Yeah.
Yeah, that's one of the themes that ran through the conference last weekend was precisely that. That unfortunately, around about the 12th century, Islam turned its back on that tradition, and that tradition needs to be recaptured.
It's working. My name's Nick Gotts from Scotland. I wonder if you could comment on the symbiotic relationship between hardline Islam and the far right, particularly what I would call the populist far right rather than the outright fascist far right, where quite justifiable opposition to Islamism and criticism of Islam is all too easily used as a cover for racism, and that in turn pushes, I think, young Muslims and also young non-Muslim minority members towards hardline Islam.
Mm. I think the recent success of the far right in Europe is a reaction to the visibility of the hardline Islam that we're seeing in the streets. The problem with the far-right reaction is that it's unsubtle. It does not distinguish between any flavor of Islam. For them, Islam is the problem, not Islamism. I think if you look in detail at the problem, however, what you see is that the hardliners, those who combine their radical Islam with their political interests, those people are quite separate from the ordinary Muslims who came here a couple of generations ago, the immigrants who were quite happy to go to their mosque on a Friday or not and didn't give a hoot about politics. And now, unfortunately, many of the Muslim communities, again, because of this Saudi funding, have been taken over by the hardliners. And this appeals enormously to young people. It gives them absolute certainty in life. They are the victims. They must fight back. It's a very, very attractive philosophy for people who live in disadvantaged communities. And the reaction to that, as I said, is unsubtle. It simply doesn't see that there is such a thing as moderate Islam. Unfortunately, our governments have been pretty blind to the problem too. And they go and ask people like Tariq Ramadan and the Muslim Council of Britain for their views, believing that they are moderates. But those people have a hardline agenda. They're just a little bit more subtle in covering it up.
Hi, you talked about the different steps that should be taken for the development of the African nations. This might not also be that much of a question as a suggestion. Should each Western nation take responsibility for the development of a certain African nation so that they would have, like, each one would be sort of like the teachers or helpers for a particular nation? And in that way, try to see how they could be developed.
Okay, could you rephrase that for me? I didn't quite get that.
Each European country is being in charge of an African country, taking care of that in developing Africa.
Well, we do have a history of Europe taking charge of African countries, and it didn't work very well, and the Africans weren't best pleased with it either. The legacy of the colonial period is not a free Africa. It's an Africa which is very largely in the hands, has fallen into the hands of a very powerful, corrupt elite. And what Western governments can do is actually stop supporting those elites and stop funding the mega projects and do the kind of things, working through non-governmental organizations, of which there are very many in Africa, and working on grassroots projects to help improve the lives of ordinary people. That's what we should be doing.
Hi. So this is also a comment rather than a question. I spent 20 years in East London, possibly a Muslim majority area of London by far. And one thing I think that needs to be mentioned is that I saw a distinct change in people's attitudes after the Iraq War in 2003. So we have hundreds of thousands of Bangladeshi families where the parents and grandparents, they're pretty laissez-faire and they're not covered up at all. Whereas we have these very, very young women. I mean, if you go to East London, Bethnal Green now, you'll find 8 out of 10 young women completely covered up in bin liners. And that's a very, very sad situation. And I think the two religious nutters, Tony Blair and George W. Bush, actually made this happen.
Steiners, could you...
Well, it's a comment, really. And then second, I do have a question as well, which is... And Nick up.
Did you say...
I said bin liners, you know that.
Bin liners, yeah. Oh, okay, burkas and
burkas,
so on.
Yeah. Oh,
okay, I didn't quite get that, yes, fine.
Anyway, second quick question. I mean, in Poland, okay, which I call the sort of Talibans of the West...
Yeah, that's becoming a really hot potato in Europe currently, whether they should be banned. I think there are very good arguments. A very nice set of arguments was put forward by the Canadian Muslim Congress about why they should be banned. They should be banned for health reasons, for security reasons, and so on. But of course, what they are a symbol of identity and identifying with hardline Islam. And the rise of hardline Islam has been certainly helped enormously by the Iraq War. One of my colleagues gave a speech at the Human Rights Council last weekend, and it was quite widely reported because it was during a 6-hour debate on women's human rights. And she got the only laugh in the entire debate. And what she said was, women's human rights are being denied right across the developing world, but no more so than in countries where women are obliged to cover themselves from head to foot. Now, the argument that we hear for this is that it's a question of modesty. But the holy text enjoined both men and women to dress modestly. Why don't we see men dressed in bin liners? Well, the answer, of course, is that it's not about that. It's about men controlling women. Another argument that we hear is that men, and presumably Muslim men, find the sight of a woman's face or hair sexually provocative and could lead them astray. And her suggestion was that maybe, Mr. President, wouldn't it be a better idea for men to stay indoors until they learnt some self-control?
Why not?
Yeah, I just want to follow up on this Muslim radicalization. I mean, this goes way back. It's not just George Bush. It starts with... President Eisenhower, immediately after the intervention in Korea, the U.S. government decided in its great wisdom that they would promote the Muslim Brotherhood, and then these Muslims would be used to destroy godless communism. And we have seen the result of that. And I think we have to realize there is a symbiosis between the hardliners in Washington and the hardliners in Mecca. You know, and the result of the recent years of conflict has been that the moderates have been wiped out on both sides. So I have one other comment. I think your comment about the cost of immigration is incorrect. Immigration of adults is a net economic benefit for the country that receives them. And finally, I have a question for you, and that is, wouldn't it be possible to prosecute the Pope in the International Criminal Court?
The last point, yes. In theory, one could indict the Pope in the International Criminal Court if the political will existed to do so, but it doesn't exist. It would be not creating a precedent, because President Bashir of Sudan has already been indicted. But of course, not all states have signed up and recognized the International Criminal Court, and any state which doesn't recognize the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court can simply not submit itself to judgment. On the question of the West's complicity in funding the Taliban and so on, certainly most of the funding that created and led to the creation of the Taliban during the Afghan war against Russia, all of that was done by the CIA. The Taliban would not exist if the CIA had not funded its creation. But since then, it has been largely funded by Saudi Arabia. For some reason I don't understand, there appears to be a taboo on criticizing Saudi Arabia, even in the UN. They are a member of the Human Rights Council. It's the only state in the world that didn't sign up to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and yet they are a member of the Human Rights Council. They have funded not just legitimate hardline activities, but for example, they give the families of every suicide bomber, make a donation to that family of $25,000. This is the Saudi government. This kind of activity goes on, yet nobody wants to talk about it, nobody wants to criticize it. Their influence has been absolutely pernicious across the world. Earlier this week, when I mentioned what had been happening in India, and that's been going on for 20 years, I was talking to a man who runs an organization called New Age Islam, based in Delhi, who's been monitoring what's happening across India. India is just about the second largest Muslim country in the world, apart from also having a population of a billion. It's got about 190 million Muslims. And over the last 20 years, their mosques, which were typically benign, fairly bland, pretty well all of them had been approached by agents of Saudi offering financial support, but suggesting that maybe they should take a new imam, somebody that they were recommending. That activity went on for a very long time until something like half the mosques in India are now under the influence of the hardliners. But in the last couple of years, according to this gentleman, whose name is Sultan Shaheen, they have become far more aggressive, and local mosques are being told, you will take this man. And the Islamists now in India are sufficiently strong that they can impose their will on the more liberal mosques. This is going to lead to immense trouble in the future. But nobody has reported this. So the West, going back to your question, the West was complicit in setting the thing up, but not in keeping it rolling.
Well, I think this problem with Saudi Arabia is so intimately connected to the Bush family that the ambassador to the U.S. was nicknamed Bandar Bush. I mean, he was lunching with Bush the day after the attack on 9/11. you cannot understand the role of Saudi Arabia without understanding the role of Washington. I mean, where did these Saudis, the Saud family, get its power? Its power comes from the Anglo-American oil company that gave basically them the backing so that they could get the oil there, you know? Where did the Iranian revolution come from? It came from the CIA overthrowing a democratically elected regime so that the British Petroleum Corporation could get back in there and suck that oil out. Mm.